Yeah, we can see, sir. We can see.
Okay, right. Just in another 20 minutes, I'll just, to be brief, sir asked to show only the cases. I'll show the cases, how an extracranial arterial disease, how is the management, how it has to be dealt with. First, the aim of this presentation is I'm going to show only the case scenarios, taking into circulation to anterior circulation is a carotid, posterior is a vertebral, and for planning for these interventions and how to plan it. This aim is how to diagnose an extracranial disease. As sir was telling, the predominantly extracranial disease management is only prevention. Though we are in the era of stroke treating with thrombolysis and thrombectomy, the aim is should be prevention of any neurological event. That is the main aim. Either you have to lower threshold of doing imaging of assessing the extracranial stenosis. Majority of the stroke patients will have an atherosclerotic plaque either in the carotid bifurcation or intracranially, which has to be picked up so that optimal medical management itself will prevent a major neurological event. The main aim of this talk is also only in the prevention of stroke. Extracranial disease is only a prevention of stroke creating a big neurological event. How to assess? If any majority of the patients who come to the neurology OPD presents with a TIA or a CVA, initially evaluated with a CT and MR. If the CT or MR is positive, like an infarct, it has to go into the stroke stroke line, how it has to be managed. If the patient is in the window period, thrombolyze, assess the carotid, whether extracranial disease is there. If it is there, patient should be planned for an elective stenting. If there is no acute infarct, then only comes the preventive strategy of angioplasty and stenting. So usually this extracranial disease is addressed to prevent a major neurological event, stroke happening. This is a patient who presented with the TIA. Routine in majority of the institution protocol, when the patient presents with the TIA, they do an MR to look for any lacunar embolic infarcts. If there is an embolic infarct, or even in a suspected patient with a TIA, if a conventional imaging like a CT or MR, cross-sectional imaging is normal, they ask for a next modality is a duplex, Nick vessel Doppler. Since the predominant are neurologists, in a Nick vessel Doppler, the vessels which are analyzed is common carotid divides into internal carotid and external carotid. We will see the common carotid from the aortic arch up to the bifurcation. Internal carotid will be seen up to this level. We are not much worried about the external carotid. So in the Nick vessel Doppler, we will see the common carotid, internal carotid, and the bifurcation. We need to assess, even if the patient is not having any infarct, the plaque should be assessed. Whatever might be the criteria like a NASET or ECST, how to assess the carotid stenosis. The management of carotid stenosis, it depends upon the percentage. How to calculate the carotid stenosis? You have to cross-section. If you're doing a CT angiogram, compared to MR angiogram, CT is more sensitive, more than 95 to 99% is sensitive. This is a digital subtraction angiogram. This is 100% sensitive. Duplex has a 70 to 80% sensitive for assessing the carotid artery disease. If there is a stenosis in a duplex imaging Doppler, two modalities to concur to take up the patient for either for endarterectomy or a carotid artery stenting. These are the two options available. Symptomatic patients, more than 70% stenosis should be treated by either of the method, like endarterectomy or with a stenting. How to assess the carotid stenosis? At the cross-sectional level, you have to draw the diameter of the internal carotid artery beyond the stenosis. There could be some post-stenotic dilatation. Distal to that, you could draw at the site of stenosis. If you calculate this, if the percentage of stenosis is more than 70%, patient should be treated by either of the method. That if the patient has recurrent TIA events, in spite of best medical management with statins and antiplatelet. This is the indication for intervention in a case of an extracranial carotid artery disease, either by endarterectomy or stenting. This is a patient who was on antiplatelet. Patient had a multiple lacunar embolic infarcts, was started on antiplatelet. In spite of that, he was throwing a shower of emboli. We will calculate the plaque depending upon whether it's an ulcerated, ugly plaque or a smooth plaque. Smooth plaque has less propensity to throw emboli. If it is an ulcerated plaque, we call it an ugly plaque, vulnerable plaque, more prone for embolic event. This has to be treated. This patient had, in spite of best medical management, he was progressive to have a multiple infarct. So we took up for the patient for a stenting. Since I will talk much about stenting, finally, one or two slides, I will tell about endarterectomy. Whenever doing a stenting, there are two ways of to do it. One, with a protection device to prevent any plaque from disturbed over here migrating into the brain, we can use an umbrella-like device. This is called as a protection device, which will be placed beyond the site of the stenosis. We will do an angioplasty either before putting a stent if the vessel is significantly narrow. You could see this is a pre-stenting video showing a tight stenosis, focal stenosis, pre and a pre-stenotic dilatation. Initially, we cross with a small wire. The protection device also might be slightly bigger. Sometimes it might not go without pre-dilatation. So in this case, we pre-dilated. Usually these vessels are pre-dilated with a coronary balloon, like coronary angioplasty, dilated with a coronary balloon. After that, we'll put a protection device distally. You could see this is a protection device. This is to prevent any vulnerable plaque getting disturbed and migrated into the brain to produce a major stroke. To avoid this, this is like a filter, like how we are filtering a water, all the blood without occluding the blood flow, which will be filtered over here so that any clots which migrates over here will get entangled in this embolic protection device. After placing the embolic protection device, we would place a this is a stent has been placed. You could see the stent is placed after placing the protection device. If the stent is adequately opened, we will not expect for a perfect anatomical cure, usually in a case of a keratin. You could see this is a post-stenting. There is a, compared to the pre-procedure, near total opening of it. Even small residual stenosis up to 15 to 20% is acceptable. If you over-dilate it, there are chances of hyperperfusion hemorrhage. These are the complications with a keratin stenting. So up to 80% opening is sufficient enough to improve the flow, intracranial flow. This is protection device, this is stent. After the stent is deployed, this protection device will be totally removed. This is post-stenting angiogram, shows good flow intracranially. Oops. Initially, there were paucity of filling of the middle cerebral artery branches. This is post-stenting, good filling was there. Is another patient with a focal stenosis. All these carotid artery stenosis, predominantly it will be very short segment stenosis, less than 1 or 1.5 centimeter. Stent will be of around 3 to 4 centimeters in length, covering from normal to normal region. When you dilate this carotid bifurcation with a balloon, there are chances there could be a drop in blood pressure, so that atropine should be ready to prevent bradycardia, or sometimes pacing also might be required. So venous approach. This is post stenting. You could see good opening of the vessel. Majority of the time we would get away with a single stent. I'll show you a case with a where we encountered long segment disease. We put a two stents. You could see this is a significant carotid artery stenosis. We couldn't pass a protection device without pre-dilatation. Very tight, 95 to 98% stenosis. This is a first stent is placed. After that, proximal also there is a narrowing. After pre-dilatation, we placed a protection device. These keratid stents are usually a self-expanding stent. Once you open it up, it will gradually expand over 1 or 2 days. There will be a mild amount of discomfort for the patient. After that, it will be normal. This is with a protection device. This is the first stent. Proximal to the stent, there is another stenosis, so which was also stented. You could see this is a second. Second stent was not fully opened, so we post-dilated with a balloon. This is a balloon which is kept inside the stent. We dilate it, the stent will open. This is after putting two stents, overlapping stent. See, there is a good intracranial flow. After placing the distal stent, proximal stenosis also was dilated and a stent was placed. This is about the anterior circulation. Sorry. Whether my screen is visible?
Visible, sir.
Well, sir. Where slides
just are not. Just over.
You are visible, sir. Slides are not visible.
Whether now it's visible, sir?
Yeah.
Now it's visible, sir. Yes, sir.
Now we'll go to the posterior circulation. We are speaking about extracranial arterial disease. Vertebral, that's a V1 and V2 segment. Predominantly stenosis happens at the V1 segment. This is also, as I said, while evaluating with the neck vessel Doppler, sometimes it might be difficult to look at the origin of the vertebral artery from the subclavian artery. Usually first part of subclavian artery gives rise to the vertebral artery. From a Doppler assessment, it is difficult to look at the stenosis. Only V2 segment we will see in a Doppler. Doppler going through the foramen transverse area, assessing with a Doppler, percentage of stenosis, quantifying a vertebral artery will be difficult. We will see only a dampened, it's a compromised flow in the V2 segment of the vertebral artery in a neck vessel Doppler. When there is a compromised flow in the Doppler, patients are at a posterior circulation TAA symptoms, then you have to ask for a CT angiogram. This patient underwent a CT angiogram, MR had a multiple lacunar infarcts in the cerebellum. CT angiogram showed a significant stenosis involving the V1 segment of the vertebral artery. So likewise, this is also a tight stenosis. Like in anterior circulation, in a posterior circulation, 95 to 99%, we will not use any protection device. Compared to the carotid, vertebral arteries are very small vessels. We will only carotid, we will use a self-expanding stent. Whereas in the vertebral, we will use a balloon-mounted stent, how it is used for a coronary circulation. We'll cross with a 1/4. This is a brachiocephalic angiogram, shows a tight stenosis of the V1 segment of the vertebral artery. We cross it with a wire. Since there was a tight stenosis, we pre-dilated. After that, we placed a stent. This is a post-stenting. These stents will be of shorter length. As I said, majority of the stenosis will be around 6 to 9 mm. We'll put a 12 mm or a 15 mm coronary stent, usually 4 or 4.5, depending upon the caliber of the vessel beyond the site of the stenosis, it will be placed. All symptomatic vertebral stenosis, if opposite side is also not well compensated, has to be treated with angioplasty and stenting. If you do angioplasty, sometimes dissection happens, it will get occluded. So always in a vertebral circulation, put a stent and come. That is safer. See, we are deploying a balloon-mounted stent. Compared to carotid, this carotid will be a self-expanding. This is a balloon-mounted exactly at the origin of the V1 segment of the vertebral artery. When you inflate the balloon, stent will get deployed. So this will be an accurate positioning of the stent. You could see good intracranial flow in the vertebral artery. This is another patient. You could see there is a tight narrowing of the left vertebral artery from the origin of the subclavian artery. This is a short stent, around 12 mm stent was placed from the origin of subclavian artery up to the vertebral artery. Since it goes through the C6 transverse process, we should optimally choose the size of the stent, doesn't kink or get occluded. This is another patient, right vertebral artery, 80% narrowing. This is post-stenting. Good flow. So you need to place your guiding catheter exactly just in the subclavian artery before the origin of the vertebral artery and cross with the 1/4 wire and put a balloon mounted stent. If it is a very tight stenosis, you can pre-dilate it. As I said, this is a planning strategy routinely we use for our extracranial carotid artery disease. whenever a patient presents with a cerebrovascular accident or a multiple episodes of transient ischemic attack, usually they undergo a CT or an MR. If a CT or MR is positive, or like an acute infarct, wait for 2 weeks. Don't intervene within the first 2 weeks. When you intervene in a case of an acute infarct, in spite of antiplatelet or thrombolysis, patient through a recurrent infarct, then you do it in an acute setting. Otherwise, always wait for 2 weeks. If there is no acute infarct in a patient with a TIA, then the Doppler shows a significant stenosis, then you have to confirm with a dual modality, with a CT angiogram or a digital subtraction angiogram. Now, it is not routinely done, CT angiogram. Why we need to do a CT angiogram? To look for tandem lesion, whether it's only an extracranial disease or an extracranial plus an intracranial disease. Similar to a Chinese population, we have a high incidence of ICAD, intracranial atherosclerotic disease. If it is also there, you need to do both together. Otherwise, only opening the extracranial disease may not suffice. So if the duplex is normal, there is no keratid or a vertebral stenosis, only medical management with antiplatelet is enough. Coming to intervention planning, now we have come to a diagnosis of an extracranial arterial disease is present. So whether to go ahead with a stenting or endarterectomy, these are the two arms, or all symptomatic keratid arterial disease. Coming to only the anterior circulation, more than 70% patients on best medical management with antiplatelet and statins. If the patients develop recurrent symptoms, patients has to be subjected either to a stenting or endarterectomy. Previously, endarterectomy results were much better. With the newer devices and the protection devices, stenting is also equally safe with less risk of all cranial nerve palsies and complications, shorter duration of hospital stay. In a keratid circulation, after there is an extracranial disease, when you're doing a CT angiogram, if there is a tandem lesion, only option is endovascular. If you're doing an endarterectomy, you cannot address the intracranial atherosclerotic disease. If there is a tandem lesion, only keratid artery stenting with an intracranial angioplasty plus or minus stenting. So if there is no tandem lesion, the patient can be subjected either for an endarterectomy or with a stenting. Some places, some neurologist or a cardiologist does keratid stenting without protection device. What is the difference? They don't put a filter or a protection device. Risk of around 5 to 10% chance while doing these intervention, the embolic material can go distally. Usually these embolic material will be more prone when the percentage of stenosis is more than 70%. If it is less than 70%, we could get away without a protection device. If it is more than 70%, risk of embolic event is very high. So always it is safer to use a protection device. There are two types of protection device, as I showed in the images. One is without occluding the flow. Intracranial flow will be going persistently throughout the procedure. Other is a proximal occlusion. We have to inflate a balloon proximally, temporarily occlude the vessel for around 30 seconds to 40 seconds, then deploy the stent and aspirate the clots, then open up, deflate the balloon. That is called as a MOMA device or a proximal protection device. At present, is not much available in India. We have only a continuous perfusion protection device. Coming to vertebral posterior circulation, the surgical options are very nil. When the patient has a posterior circulation TAA, or multiple embolic infarcts not responding to best medical management, you have to endovascular treatment is the best option. If it is only the V1 segment, proximal, osteoproximal segment of the vertebral artery, you have to use a balloon mounted stent. Usually the stenosis are not that common in the V2 segment. V3 or V4 are considered as similar to an ICAD. You do an angioplasty, put a self-expanding stent if the patient is affordable. All patients who underwent these interventions, either stenting or endarterectomy, should be periodically followed with a Doppler imaging. Doppler should assess for any recurrence of stenosis or a neointimal hyperplasia within the stent. The amount of redo of these procedures with a keratid stenting or a vertebral stenting are very less than 5%. Touch wood, maybe I have not done any patient with a keratid stenosis or stenting. We have not redo the procedure. Stenosis has not recurred if the patient adequately adhere to the medications. Usually after stenting, we put the patient on dual antiplatelet. Usually the patient will be in ICU because blood pressure management for a day or two. After that, shifted to the ward, patient will be discharged in day two or day three. Usually the patient will be started on dual antiplatelet, maybe 3 to 6 months after that change to single antiplatelet. The patient should be lifelong on antiplatelet to prevent recurrence of an event. This is our post-procedure management of an extracranial arterial disease. Usually these are done mainly to prevent the stroke. As I said, this is only a team effort, optimal patient preparation, evaluation, first medical management by a neurology team should be adequately done. Then the patient should be adequately evaluated for tandem lesions. If there is a tandem lesion, endovascular is the best option. If it is a symptomatic, in spite of this medical management, you can give both options for the patient, like an endarterectomy and a stenting. Depending upon the feasibility at your place, you can decide whether to go with a stenting or endarterectomy. I think I've completed, sir.